Good morning, everybody.
Yay.
Everything worked perfectly. There were no problems at all. Excellent. How are y'all?
Good, Steven. How are you? We all want to know how you're doing.
I'm super great. Why do you want to know how I'm doing?
Well, I think, let me ask the real specific question we want to know. When did you go to bed? And when did you actually go to bed? Because you were up all night playing Zelda.
Actually, so strangely.
What are you going to say? And then what did you actually do?
So, how can I answer this in the most interesting way? I actually didn't play any Zelda last night.
What?
It was shocking. I got home and like, I don't know, I just wanted to be super chill. So I watched the last two episodes of season two of Better Call Saul, which is just so good. It's so good. And then I watched an episode of Breaking Bad, and then I went to bed at 11:30.
Wow, what a responsible young man.
I it was not an exciting evening in the life of Steven, but it was a nice one. It was very chill.
Good.
Yeah. That is good.
But Zelda is super good. Did you get it yet, Eric?
No, it's no. Seattle has zero Nintendo Switches.
Yep.
Zero. Unless I'm going to charge like $600 off some guy on the street. Nope. So I'm going to have to wait.
That is not a smart choice at the moment.
Not a smart choice.
Not a smart choice. What's the last thing I did in Zelda? I was exploring a new zone because I'm trying to get to another ancient tech lab so that I can make fancy equipment from all the screws and stuff that I got from Guardians that I've fought. So, it's just so fun because, like, I'll kind of set this nebulous goal in my head, and I'll just sort of wander in the direction of that goal, generally. And then there's just a ton of shit that's super fun to do that pulls me onto sidetracks. And it's like, oh, look, there's a shrine over there. Oh, my God, I found a Korok. Oh, check it out. Here's a quest that's telling me to go. Like, it's right over there. It's super close. I'm just going to go take care of it. It's fine.
Just
8 hours later. Yep, exactly. it is good. And unfortunately, it's going to be a while before I get to play it again because all day today I'm playing role-playing games.
Ah, darn.
Terrible.
Your life is so hard.
It is. What have you been up to, Eric? How's life?
Pretty good, pretty good. I've been getting sucked into that PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds. I've been doing
that.
Any moment when I'm not actually like doing a bunch of stuff, I'm working on a lot of art projects right now for upcoming shows. So I've been working on that too. And between that and my role-playing games, that's been my life right now.
Yeah. Chat, you should be very excited to see what Eric has been putting together because it looks beautiful. Looks gorgeous, Eric. Yeah.
And it involves this shirt that I'm wearing.
Yeah. The wheel that burns. That's what I should call it from now on. Luke, you failed at naming your product.
Failed.
Sure. Yeah.
Sure.
Thanks, Steven. I'll just go burn the books.
Yeah, that good. Yep. Excellent.
How could anyone burn such an amazing, beautiful,
beautiful.
They are incredible books.
Okay. It's enough on all of you.
All of yous.
Jess, how are you?
What
have you been up to?
Deflection. I'm good. I'm doing well. I haven't been playing a whole lot of stuff. I've actually been trying to be less on the computer this week. But that's mostly just because I've been dealing with like house stuff. I don't know if you guys heard, but my house exploded. We had a storm and my roof got pretty ducked and there's trees everywhere.
Wow.
So I've been dealing with like real life adult things that aren't super fun. Ugh. But I am super excited about Star Wars because I love Star Wars and the Last Jedi trailer was really good and it's gonna be awesome. And I just, oh my God, I just feel like this could possibly be the most interesting direction that they've taken in Star Wars so far, because if you saw The Force Awakens, you know that it's literally A New Hope and they took no chances whatsoever.
Yep.
So I'm really excited.
Yeah.
End same of story.
for all of those same reasons. We're not gonna talk about the trailer. We're not going to say any spoilers about what we think the story is going to be. But
but please, in this instance, do at me. Do at me.
Yeah.
Okay.
We
need to talk.
About?
About the B word that's in the trailer and what that implies.
The B word?
B word?
Yeah. See, no, not that B word. Another B word. Let's talk off air later.
Yeah, okay.
Must be discussions.
You're gonna have to drop the B word into chat so that we understand what you're talking about.
There you go. God.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
Wait.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Y'all I wish you could read what Luke just wrote, but only if you want to. Yeah.
Definitely.
Luke, what have you been up to?
It's been a busy work week. I'm preparing for travel, lots of travel. I'm going to Berlin for a week to speak at this thing called Games Week Berlin, which is a super cool event put on by my friend Michael Lieb. And then a couple weeks after that, I'm off to Japan to visit my friend Andy Kakowski and to go to Bit Summit in Kyoto, where Kickstarter will be exhibiting. So it's just a lot of work to prep for these events. Wrapped up a Burning Wheel campaign last night, which was very interesting. Actually managed to get it into a fight. Like, even with my veteran Burning Wheel players, sometimes it can be a struggle when there's so many people at the table, but we managed to have a fight with nearly everyone at the table involved, which was super cool. So, if you know Burning Wheel, it's a big deal.
All right. Luke, are you going to Japan to meet Andy as in, like, Ryotama translator Andy?
Yeah. Andy's a friend of mine.
That's so awesome! You're friends with him! That's so cool!
Yeah, Andy and I helped Andy with the Tenra Bunch of Zero.
Oh!
I did the layout for Tenra.
Wow.
But Andy and I have known each other for ages, since the dawn of the weirdo indie RPG scene. Andy used to run the Indie RPG Awards, which is this small little awards circle thing. But he has since passed that off. But he's an amazing fella. He's a good guy.
That's awesome.
So, yep.
You're telling me he has a lot of fans.
I will.
If he doesn't know already.
He'll be excited to hear it. I mean, he's doing amazing work with those translations, like bringing those games.
Yeah, he is. He's doing work. It's awesome. Yeah.
It's real work and like such important work. And I mean, the Japanese RPG scene is just like fucking mind blowing. Just really incredible.
Yep.
Have you played Shinobi Gama or Gami? Shinobi Gami, whatever.
No, I haven't, but I've heard about it.
Yeah. They did a Kickstarter for it. I don't know if it's done yet. But I play tested it with them once and it's crazy. Highly recommended.
Nice.
Anyway, hi.
My cat has been trying to chew on all of my cords, and she'll like get one bite in and then she'll be like, because I put a whole bunch of bitter stuff on them, and I didn't notice until just now, but apparently she drooled all over my shoulder, which is just fantastic. So great, thanks.
Revenge, thanks,
cat. Yeah. Revenge. Cut that out.
Oh my god.
She is a handful and a half. Ugh. Yeah, so, the other thing that happened to me this week is that I went to the physiotherapist for my wrist and got, like, some tape put on it, so yeah.
That's good.
It was super interesting. So I've been going to the gym this year for, like, the first time in, like, my life, which is great, but it also means that you're gonna hurt yourself, so I did.
Yeah.
It wasn't anything major or, like, no sort of big event was like, crack, whatever, but... Over time, like, my wrist started hurting whenever it was bent back like this, and especially if I put any weight on it. So, like, bench presses and stuff like that was really not working well for me. Mm-hmm. And so, I went to the physio and I was like, hey, here's this problem, whatever. And she was like, okay, well, like, do all these weird things with your arms. And then she was like, oh, yeah, your left shoulder is, like, super weak compared with your right one. And, like, your pec is sort of pulling your shoulder forward, and it's, like, radiating all these problems down into your wrist. So we're going to tape your wrist so that, like, it tightens up the ligaments there so that they it gives your hand more support, and you're going to do these exercises to strengthen your hand muscles or whatever. And then we're going to give you all these stretches and, like, exercises to help your shoulders feel better. And, like, physio exercises, if you've never been to physio, they're really, really weird little things that you would never expect to be challenging, and then you do them, and they're just the hardest thing in the world.
Yeah, kind of like the thing where you, like, keep your arm out for, like, a minute or whatever. Like, weird things that hurt support muscles in ways that you didn't know you had.
Yeah, even simpler things than that. So what I have to do is I have to press my pinkies against the wall, and then make sure that my elbows are inside of my hands, and then raise my arms, sliding them against the wall like that until they're straight.
Just like praising the sun?
Yes, I'm praising the sun. That is exactly what I'm doing. And I'm supposed to press gently against the wall as I praise the sun.
Okay.
And my shoulder muscle right here is sore. It is sore from praising the sun.
That's a weird angle.
This one, not sore at all. Yeah. But it's wild.
Dang.
But it's totally awesome. Working, so that's great. And I'll be taped up for like 6 weeks. So awesome.
Keep it up, man. Yeah. You can work out too.
Yeah, exactly. Man.
And you should, and it's awesome. And then the best thing I think going to the gym does is actually the mental aspects of it, of just like, oh yeah, I went to the gym today. It feels really good that I went to the gym.
Yeah.
My body feels like it's dying, but my brain feels great. There's definitely something there. I'm not talking about like a runner's high. I'm not talking about like working out high. Like it's just like
you literally just feel better about yourself.
Yeah, you just feel better about yourself in a way that I can't really describe.
It is true.
Do it. Do it.
I'm gonna just center you in the window a little bit, Eric. There you go. Now you're better. Yes, of course. Try not to wait until you're 31, because then you'll have to go to physio, which is also great and hilarious. So like, it's not a problem, but.
Learning about your body is good.
Do it now. Actually, like, I think if I were to be in another field, it might actually be like sports medicine and physiotherapy if it weren't video games, because it's just like super cool and it's like so like muscle memory and I don't know, it's super neat.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would be an Arthurian knight in another world.
Aww.
Speaking of which.
Well, lucky for you.
Speaking of which.
I actually would not want to do an Arthurian knight. That sounds like a horrible time.
Yeah, it sounds like bad times.
It would feel like 10% really good and 90% really, really hard.
Yeah.
For sure. So, Hrethric.
You get very quiet on this.
I'm just writing down your children. Hrothmund and Manfroid.
Yeah, man, that's my mom's kid, though. It's not.
Oh, that's your mom's kid. Okay, you're right. Yeah, baby Hrothmund, single baby Hrothmund.
Yep.
And we already determined that Hrothmund is going to be a knight, and he's like 6 years old now, right?
Hrothmund is due to die any minute.
Yeah.
You know, he's getting on, you know, for a baby.
Getting on in years. okay, cool. So, first, why don't we talk about what happened last session? Nidian, Hrethric, can one of you fill us in and recount our tales to Elaine?
It was like, last session was like a Coen Brothers movie.
Yeah.
All right.
Where, you know, at the end of the session... Nidian and Hrethric have murdered somebody. They didn't mean to. They're kind of standing there with blood up to their elbows. Like, everybody's milling around. Nobody seems to really care. They're feeling really awkward. They feel like they've done something terrible. But then people start congratulating them, and they're like, yay!
Wait, did you kill someone last session?
Like, I became a time traveler or something last session. Like, now we've split. Like, Hrethric Prime is in another time stream, and now this is right. Hrethric A or something, where I killed Gorlois.
You didn't kill Gorlois, did you? You did kill Gorlois.
I delivered the killing blow.
Yes.
Multiple.
Yes.
Repeated killing blows.
Oh, whoopsie.
Right, yeah, that's what happened last
time. With session. His own axe.
Yeah.
Did he, do something shitty to...
He killed Prince Madoc in front of me, which is pretty much...
Okay.
So it was in a battle.
Okay.
Right? There was a battle that was happening.
It's not unwarranted.
Yes.
It's an unwarranted murder.
Igraine and Uther fell in love, and that's what was causing the stress between the three of them. Gorlois was trying to, save his marriage, so he declared war on Uther, like you do if you're a boss of Cornwall.
The boss of Cornwall.
You know.
Yeah. And Igraine was torn, she was trying to help them both, but maybe helped Uther a little more? I'm actually not entirely clear on exactly what happened there, but regardless, Uther went to Igraine in a glamour, and Igraine knew it was him. They plotted Gorlois' downfall or something? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Igraine is definitely complicit in the murder of Gorlois. And then Gorlois led a night raid on Prince Madoc's camp. I chopped him up with his axe.
Cool.
I mean, after Nidian very bravely and cautiously led us through the fight, we chose the most cautious way to go. We put on our armor and got on our horses and made our way opponent by opponent to mm-hmm. where the battle was happening, where we were given the choice to rush it. And we decided not to, sensing it was a fucking trap. So I don't know if we actually could have saved Prince Madoc. I don't think we could. But Madoc's dead.
Yeah.
Gorlois lodged his sword in Madoc's ribs from
the top. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Shit.
And then I went berserk and knocked him off his horse and chopped him up into little pieces.
Yep, and everybody was super enthusiastic about you having done that. You led the charge into Castle Terrabil, right?
Oh, I led the sack of Terrabil, Nidian and I. Which I Hrethric doesn't remember that part.
Yep, he was blanked out. That was Hrethric Prime, not Hrethric A.
Fuck. Damn.
Yeah.
Wow.
Cool. Uther has announced his impending marriage to Igraine. You all attended the funeral for Prince Madoc. And who else died? Sir Elid, who had trained you as young squires and put you forward into knighting, was also killed in the battle. Yes. So, Elaine.
Yes.
We have to figure out what has happened to you in the meantime.
Yes.
So, first of all, I think we may not have done your manor for last year.
No. Mm-mm.
So this is the year 491. So really quickly, let's just whip through that.
Sure.
Yes.
Let's do your normal income, which is 6 pounds. 6 librum, sorry. They're not actually pounds.
Yes. All right. And then an investment. I did buy some stuff.
It looks like you have a dove coat that gives you two librum.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And then I have to roll for apiary. It's 1d2.
Yep, yep, yep.
Yep.
All right. You rolled one.
It's one or the other.
Yeah, sure.
So 3.
Let's see. We'll show this off. Great. And then you need to sum up your maintenance costs.
Mm-hmm.
So that looks like it's 4 for the ornamental garden unicorn enclosure.
I bought a unicorn, you guys.
Did you buy a unicorn or a unicorn enclosure?
Well, both.
Hang
it's
on.
One unicorn in an enclosure.
You just bought
which
a unicorn?
Which gives me 2 glory.
Oh my god, do you want to play Pendragon Zoo Tycoon?
Yeah.
Yes.
I am beyond jealous. I didn't even realize you could buy a unicorn.
Yes! You can.
Don't you look like a fool giving Sir Lycus 100 librum now?
Oh, yeah. I've totally forgotten about that. But yeah, what the hell? I could have had a unicorn.
Yes, you. Yeah, there you go. Maintenance per animal is 1 librum per year. Glory for 1, 2, 5, 10. Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, and then you can spend more librum to decrease the chances of it dying, right, which I'll probably be doing.
Wow. Yeah, that's going to be grim if the...
Yeah. It's an extra, what is it, Steven? An extra 2 librum?
If what?
To decrease fatality.
Let's see. It looks like, wow, what? Fatality or decrease fatality. It says 1 through 10/01 through 05. Oh, I guess those are the,
numbers.
You need to, right, okay, I see. That's like you roll a d20 to see if the animal survives each year. And then if you spend another 2 librum, you get the decreased fatality range instead of the normal fatality range.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So you need to spend 3 librum a year to keep your unicorn only a 25% chance of dying instead of a 50% chance of dying.
But I believe that counts toward the annual glory for the creature.
That makes sense.
Because it's like you're lavishing expense on the unicorn.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
You're buying it like a tea set.
Yep. That is exactly what it wants.
Little outfits.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
You're having friends over to play with it. Awesome. Uh-huh. So note down your total maintenance costs in the maintenance column.
Okay, so 1 is, and then 3.
Okay.
6. That's a lot.
Is that the only unicorn?
No.
Okay, good.
No, there are many unicorns across Britain. Oh,
thank God.
It was the last unicorn.
I'm going to cry now. Bye, guys.
You can have like 5 units.
I'm not crying, you're crying.
All right, let's do your manorial luck. So you need to roll 1d6.
I'm sorry, what?
Roll 1d6. Roll 1d6, Elaine, for your manorial luck.
I just like closed everything.
Nice.
1d6. 3.
3. You have had a calamity. Roll 1d20.
Welcome to Pendragon.
I know, it would be boring otherwise.
A dragon destroys your
17.
Oh no!
Your unicorn dies.
Disease struck your animals. You get a +6 to your fate.
Okay. Now you have. Oh.
Okay, that's all right.
What happens if, what kind of weird things happen to fleas who drink the blood and eat the skin of a unicorn?
Now, I'm pretty sure that your fate was like 11 last year. It was quite low.
Oh.
Let me take a look. Yes. Okay, so the weather was 11. So, Elaine, in the... in the fate column, you would write 17.
Yep.
So 11. So is it 10? Because I have bees.
Yes.
Bees.
So it's 16.
Yes.
Okay.
All in all, pretty good. Like weather has been getting better over the years for y'all. All right. So then, I believe we check your care, which is a roll of your concern for my commoners.
Mm-hmm.
So go ahead and roll that. Oh, not so great. But that's okay. That just means that you get no benefit from your care. So I will roll your misfortune, and you will roll your stewardship. So misfortune failed, so you got a pretty good shot. Oh. So of course you're rolling your wife's Lillian's stewardship here.
Yep.
She succeeds, and a success versus a failure means that you stewards die roll a success. Yeah, you have a good harvest this year.
Nice.
Wow, that's my first good.
It is. Very nice. Okay, and then you can make additional expenses from your treasury to bring yourself up to the ordinary knight level.
Okay.
And then you can determine how many improvements you want to build at a later date. But
so if what should we be doing with emergency income?
Emergency income is like
savings.
No, emergency income is like if you need to if you need to chop down trees. That's what Nidian did his very first year.
Okay.
Emergency income is when you squeeze your peasants. Y'all have been effectively bumped out of needing emergency income as a result of being the ones to capture King Octa.
Yes.
But yeah. The other thing that happened last year is Hrethric had a party.
That's true.
Yep.
He had a he threw a party. And there were a bunch of people who attended. Dwinwin ended up going upstairs with a lovely knight and sleeping with her on Hrethric's dead wife's bed, which was very Days of Our Lives.
Yeah.
Yeah, God.
Shout out to Dwin. Classy.
Classy. And Hrethric had a scene where he called Nidian and Dwinwin in and Sir Lycus. And he told Sir Lycus that he had collected 25 Librum from each of you and presented Sir Lycus with a gift of 100 Librum. However, Nidian and Dwinwin knew that he had never approached them for 25 Librum. So what has actually happened is that Hrethric gave Sir Lycus 100 Librum from his own personal accounts. And
wow.
Nidian and Dwinwin sort of stood idly by and were like, yep, that's what happened.
Mm-hmm. To his credit, Nidian did kind of try to cover his ass with a weird gift that he was going to give to me, but he gave to Lycus.
Nidian chose to re-gift.
Wow, was, drama.
Yeah. But really, Hrethric gave 100 Librum to Sir Lycus, and his two companions just stood there and went like, sure, good job.
Yep. Yep. So, all right.
I'm not honest.
That's true. Yep. All right. So, Elaine.
Yes.
Let's find out what you were up to last year while all of these events were taking place. So,
honesty is literally my lowest score.
And now that you have at long last raised your Valorous. Because it used to be your Valorous was the lowest score, right?
Yeah, I know.
That was great.
I had honesty, and my honesty and Valor were my lowest scores. So if you're ever wondering why I was such a weirdo.
All right. So I think you have three opportunities here. You can either have a solo adventure dealing with your own land. And you sort of like judge disputes between your commoners or something like that. We'll see like what kind of a year y'all had. Or you can go.
There was an example of that with me and the shepherds of someone stealing my sheep.
Yep.
Like that's
the similar sort of thing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But there's more options.
Or you can enter into vassal service for your lord and perform, for example, garrison duty or border patrol or an armed escort, those sorts of things. And those generally give you various checks to your skills. Or you can get lost in the woods.
Yeah.
And, I don't know why you might have gotten lost in the woods. Maybe you were off on a hunting outing and you simply got lost. But it's up to you, Jess, which of these you think befell your character.
Is holding a crossroads also on the table?
Holding a crossroads is a later adventure.
Oh,
it's later in Arthurian legend, similar with the Lover's Solo. I think the crossroads kind of begins in... I would say it begins in the Forest Sauvage era, in the next period, the Anarchy period.
Got it. Cool. Okay.
Yeah. All and right. The Lover's Solo begins in King Arthur period, in the Romance era.
Cool. So it's the basically dealing with her manor, vassal service, or getting lost in the woods.
Yep.
I mean, last time Elaine got lost in the woods, she got a dope spring out of it. So
true.
Let's do that.
What could go wrong?
Let's go on an adventure.
Let's go on an adventure.
Die.
All right. So, how did you get lost in the woods? Were you coming back from someone's house? Were you going out on a hunt and you just got turned around?
Turned around on a hunt.
Awesome.
Pretty standard hunt.
Yeah.
But somehow something weird happened.
Let's find out what kind of prey you were hunting. Mm. Hang on, I'll tell you what to roll, and then it will, the hunting chart will tell us what prey you were pursuing. Nope.
Could it? Do you want to try for the hunting thing to actually be you capturing the unicorn?
Ooh.
That could be cool.
Yeah, absolutely. That sounds super cool.
Sure.
Where are those skills? Where are
That's
they?
Far better than
I mean, you
one.
Could like hunt like a quail or something too if you want.
All right, great, cool. Roll 1d20 for me.
Okay.
Yeah.
6.
6.
Oh,
nice. Yes. So you set out on your hunt. Your hounds baying about your horse as you trek through the forest. Fairly quickly, you come upon the tracks of a red deer.
Nice.
Yes. And this is, you know, this is a decent prize. It'll feed your household for a week or two. You know, its hide will look beautiful, cured up into a nice leather that, you know, your peasants can work into something nice. You know, it's not terribly glorious or anything like that, but it's decent. So you get into the woods, and fairly quickly, you know, you become completely turned around. The tangle of the forest closes in around you. In fact, you start feeling like there's another undercurrent in the forest that you haven't felt before when you ventured out, and it feels like things are just a little wilder, a little more untamed. And this is probably after all of the battle at Tintagel and Terrible. So you're probably maybe like feeling a little bit of the tenor of the country itself in response to the events that are going on.
Nice.
Yeah. So you end up falling asleep, and all your dogs are going hungry, and maybe you've lost some of them along the way. They'll be fine. They'll make their way home. But you wake up the next day. They are good boys. You wake up the next day and you're completely turned around. So roll 1d20 on your lost in the woods table.
Ooh. Whoa. 18.
18. Ah, you find a manor. Let's see.
A manor on my property?
But this is not on your property. You've gone
I'm
out.
I'm like super lost.
You're into the woods.
Okay.
And you're hunting in the wilds. Yeah. Let's see. Okay. Yes. Well. Elaine, please roll 2d6 five times.
Okay. Whoa.
All right. 1. Two, three, four, five.
Right. Okay. And then roll 1d6 again.
Okay.
What the hell?
6. Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah, so you enter a clearing in the forest, and you smell the scent of cook fires, and you see a large house, like a mansion built in the forest in this clearing. There's a well, and there's a small field with some grains and some cows grazing on the pastures here in this clearing. And the manor is flying a blue flag with a I guess with a hawk emblazoned on it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cool.
What do you do when you approach this manor?
I think I hail it. I think I'm curious. I think I want to try to find out who lives there.
Yeah, okay. So you're just like shouting from in front of it, you know, hail, lord of the manor, you know, that sort of
thing. Yeah, like, you know. Not like, oh, I've lost my way or something like that. Just like, oh, hello. I was out traveling and I found you.
Yeah. Would you like to make a courtesy check for that?
Sure.
Go ahead and roll it.
courtesy.
Oh, nope. Nope. Okay, so yeah, you yell something. You make your presence known, and the door slams open. Wha-bam! And there is there's a woman there in full armor with helm, shield, spear, and sword buckled at her side. She is she's very fashionably dressed. Her armor is well taken care of. You know, her hair is tied back neatly in a set of like two buns on the back of her head. She's got a bright blonde flaxen hair. And she greets you very moderately. Mm-hmm. It looks like she has a fairly average level of wealth. And you can see from inside, there's a young man who is very fashionably dressed in formal clothes, and he has a ledger in his hand, and he's writing something. And it looks like he's sort of calling out to her, but she doesn't respond.
Okay.
Yeah, and she looks at you, and she says, "What's this? A knight? How come you to be on my property, knight?"
I'm probably like filthy yeah. by now, yeah. but I'm trying to look as tall as I possibly can.
You slipped and fell into a mud pie climbing up a cliff yeah. or something like that.
There's like little flies coming off of me.
Yes.
Stink lines, you know.
Mm-hmm. She holds her hand up to her nose.
I say something to the effect of, "My lady, I am your neighbor from Newton Tony, and I don't believe we have met. I was traveling my property and decided to explore further and came upon your very, very proud-looking manor and wanted to introduce myself."
Yeah, she, her eyebrows raise, like, higher and higher as you speak. She says, "On neighbors? Most assuredly not. It is days' travel to the nearest manor from here through the forest. I have chosen this location purely for its most temperate separation from the indulgences of society."
"Oh, certainly, certainly. Your grounds are lovely and have a wildness to them."
"And what was it you said? Proud, I think you said? You called my manor proud, I believe."
"Oh, well, I would certainly be proud."
"How
of such a glory.
Dare you?" her eyes are like burning, and she's just looking at you like, "Oh, this filth on my lawn." She's mad. You can tell.
I'm like a literal pile of shit right now. I'm the shit emoji.
With the happy smiley face. Yeah. "Hi, I found your manor. It looks great."
"Hi."
Yes. She says, "Be gone, or I will be you gone." Wait, what? You understand?
Yes, I actually do, and I apologize, and I like bow as lowly as I possibly can, and back away from her door.
Okay, nice. So you're just gonna back away?
Yeah.
Okay.
She's like, I just like interrupted her life for no reason.
Yeah, totally. That's yeah. All right. Back into the woods. How are you feeling here in the late afternoon after your terrible running with this mysterious man?
Horrible. Horrible.
It's about to get worse, Elaine.
True.
You hear, and then all of a sudden, rain just starts pouring down from the heavens. You slip in the mud at your feet and slide down into a gully. Roll 1d20.
Yeah.
10.
10. Okay. Oh, that's good. Oh, that's very interesting.
If this is the whole session, I am totally cool with that.
It's just Eric and Luke watching just
the calamity of Elaine.
The calamity of Elaine. Awesome. Okay, where is that table? 4-4. We're very close. There we go. Roll 1d20, Elaine.
Okay. You're totally fine, and you just took a shower in the rain. And...
Yes, totally. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Wow. Okay.
Stephen.
I love this. It's so fun. These procedural adventures are great. Because they're surprising for me, too.
Oh, that's right. This is your thing, isn't it?
It is my thing. Actually, I've been seriously considering turning the Forest Sauvage into a hex crawl. So we will see.
I mean, yeah.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Elaine, roll 2d4.
Okay.
3. Okay. So it's the next day, and you've slept overnight, and your mouth is kind of gross. You're still with your horse. You've been surviving on your beef jerky or whatever you brought along with you, and drinking from streams. You know, you're a little bit cleaner now that you've had the rain wash off most of the poo. you're wandering through the forest, and you see a break in the forest ahead, and it might look like the edge of your property.
I'm very excited by this and not suspicious at all, and I run toward it.
Awesome. Cool. You run out, it's not your property, unfortunately, but it looks like it was like some sort of old rundown manor, maybe, you know, 10 years back, but it's all overgrown and like it's been abandoned and whatever. So there's a moment where you're just a little bit crestfallen at the twist, and then you hear from off to your right.
Ooh. Oh my lord.
Oh, good.
Yes. And off to your right from the forest just behind you pads a large wolf with thick gray hairs bristling on the back of its neck. And it looks at you and your hounds and your horse, and it snarls. What do you do?
I'm not on my horse, right?
You have your horse with you. You're either on it or you're walking it. So it's there.
I mean, I meet the wolf.
You meet the wolf?
Yes.
Like with hand outstretched to shake?
No, not in a friendly way.
Okay, all right. you pull your weapons off of your back and go to encounter. Okay.
I'm probably pretty hungry.
Oh, nice. Yeah, you're like, oh, great, wolf feast.
Yeah.
All
I'm
right.
Like so hungry and covered in poop that I'm like, food.
God. Okay, hang on. I'm sure that I have some sort of wolf asset that I can pull out here. Oh, yeah, totally. Wolf token.
Good wolves, Brent.
They're good wolves, Brent. All right, wolf. And let's take a look at its hit points. Mm-hmm. And its armor. 2. Cool. Yeah, the wolf snarls at you as you rush to meet it. And you join battle. So what kind of attack are you making against this wolf? Are you charging on your horse? Are you using your sword? What are you doing?
I would like to be on horseback.
Okay,
if cool. I can just say that I was already on my horse.
Mm-hmm.
With my lance, charging at it, but not necessarily trying to stab it. More just trying to like shoo it away.
Oh, interesting.
Show that I'm like larger than it and I'm not a meal for it.
Yeah, you're just trying to like shoo it off. All right. So the wolf, it's kind of just trying to dodge your charge a little bit. It's kind of fainting with you. So roll your attack with a +5. Okay. Yeah, so you can tell very obviously, like as you charge at this wolf, it's not feeling scared or threatened or shooed off at all. In fact, it maybe feels emboldened that you're not actually trying to attack it. And it deftly avoids the strike of your spear. And suddenly, from the brush nearby, charge two more wolves, launching Yay! Themselves at you.
Bye, Elaine.
Oh no! Oh my god, wolf crit! Okay, so this wolf charges at you, and it latches its jaws on your leg, and it shakes, tearing at your flesh. Yeah, dealing you 26 damage, which ends up being 10, boy. Accounted for by your armor, right?
Yeah.
So,
I have chivalry, though, so it's...
Oh, yeah, okay. So seven.
Seven.
Seven. So
nice!
Take a wound of seven damage.
All right.
And then also make a test to stay on your horse.
Hmm. Where is that? Skills?
Yeah, it's a horsemanship.
There it is.
Ha! Oh, very nice. Okay, you're still on your horse. That's fine.
And then you have your super saddle too, so.
Yes.
I do have my super saddle.
Okay, the second wolf bites at you, but its teeth get stuck in your leather greaves, so you're fine.
Okay.
And your hounds charge up. Let's say you've got six hounds. And you can chase off a wolf if you spend four hounds, but three of them will get killed. You can occupy a wolf with three hounds. But they'll all get killed and the wolf won't go anywhere, so you'll have to deal with it later. I'll make a note here on the map so that we can keep track of the options available to you. So, chase off a wolf. Chase off. Cost four wolves. Four hounds. Three die. Occupy a wolf. Cost three hounds. One dies. We're going to do it like that. So those are the ways you can spend your hounds in terms of wolf encounter.
And I have four total?
You have six total.
Six total, okay.
Let's see. I'll mark that down. Six hounds. And, of course, yourself.
Occupy and kill! Occupy and kill!
So... what are you going to do this time? You've got three wolves, one you, six hounds.
Passion.
Now, hatred of wolves.
Hatred of wolves.
You might walk away with a hatred of wolves.
Yeah, right. I don't know what could possibly... Yeah, I don't think any passions make sense. Do they?
Let me take a look at what passions you have. I mean, honor, loyalty, hospitality, hate, love.
I guess my honor, like if I die covered in shit, eaten by wolves.
No,
that's
this is
not very honorable.
This is not an honor fight.
Yeah, it's not really about your reputation in knightly standing. Yeah. I think you might be out of passions here as well.
That's all right. You're between your horse and your lance and the wolf and the hounds, you should be able to pick off one wolf.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, your horse and your lance alone should give you +5, +10.
Yeah.
Yep.
You fell into the wolf trap. That's all.
It's fine.
I don't want to have to sacrifice my puppies.
So, but I mean, like, you can divide your skill and then fight all three wolves yourself, right? That's fine.
No, but, like, if... Like, that's Jess. But, like, if I were a fucking knight, I would have a kennel full of dogs and I wouldn't care. They're hunting dogs.
Right.
That's what they're for, right?
The least amount of damage to the dogs is to have them hold off two of the wolves. You kill one. And the next round, they hold off one. You kill the other one.
Yep.
And... kill the third.
So I'll do...
I'm giving you a third option. You can spend two hounds on a wolf to distract it and reduce its combat skill by five. But one of those hounds will die. you're throwing hounds to the wolves in order to give yourself combat advantage here.
Throw to the wolves!
Oh, meat shield does.
Yeah.
Okay, I will do. No, I'll do the two rounds of occupy. So split my hounds.
Okay.
Between two wolves.
Yes.
And then charge at the remaining wolf.
Yeah. Okay. So you're down to four hounds, and you're tackling the initial wolf with the gray hackles on its back, the back of its head. Okay.
Yes.
So go ahead and roll. Now you've got plus 10 because you're using a lance and you're on your horse.
All right.
Oh yeah, you crit. So roll your horse damage twice.
My horse damage?
Yeah, your horse damage is 66.
Oh.
Yeah. Whenever you're charging on your horse, you don't actually use your knightly damage because it's not about your strength of swing, right? It's about your horse bodily throwing you against your opponent.
Ugh. Twice?
Yep. Because you crit, right? So that's 34 total damage. This wolf has an armor of 2, so that's 32. His health bar looks like that. So it is dead. You have slain a wolf.
Ah!
Let's see, how much glory do you get for that? 5. So just mark down, you've won 5 glory. Okay, so let's see, you're down to 4 hounds, and you've got 2 wolves left. What are you going to do? You can occupy one wolf again while you kill the other.
I mean, what's the difference between occupy and distract then?
So occupy is it doesn't fight you at all. It's fighting the hounds. Distract is it's fighting you, but the hounds are distracting it.
Okay.
So what is that? Like a plus 5, minus 5 or something?
Yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Exactly.
I'll do occupy again.
Okay.
And then charge the second one.
All right, go for it. Oh no! Okay, wow, you both crit. I wonder what that means. You got a higher crit, actually, so you win.
Yep.
Ha.
66 again?
Yeah, well, 12d6.
Whew!
Whoa.
It's 12d6 total.
Yep.
Yeah, 43. Awesome, minus 41. Elaine, Wolf Slayer, just destroys a second wolf, giving yourself another 5 glory. And then your 3 hounds remaining, plus this one wolf who's circling you. Are you just going to engage it in combat? Are you going to spend one of your wolves to distract it, to give yourself a bonus?
Yeah.
Okay.
I probably don't need it, but yeah.
You toss 2 hounds at it. One of them gets ravaged by its jaws as it's charging at you, but it is distracted, so it only has a skill of 15.
Excellent.
Okay, go for it. Yep. Well, so you have a plus 10, so that would be a 16, which is fine. You don't crit. But you still... Oh, no, because you should also get a plus 5 because your hound is distracting the wolf. So that gives you a total of 21, which is a crit. So
yes.
You're on a horse for plus 5, you're using a lance for plus 5, and you're distracting the wolf for
Forgot
an additional
to distract.
Plus 5. So you have a total plus 15, so you crit.
Awesome. Sorry.
19. Oh, okay. Oh, roll again.
Even though there's only one?
Yeah. Well, you crit. So critting always doubles your damage dealt.
26.
Good lord. So that's what, 35? 45. Yeah, you decimate this last wolf, slaying it, laying it low. Elaine, Wolf Slayer, mighty and victorious.
Yes.
Nice.
All right, excellent. So, mark down, you've earned 15 glory for slaying wolves, being lost in the woods, and for achieving such a great victory, I'm going to give you a plus 5 on your next lost in the woods roll. So, you make camp for the night in the ruins of this manor. You eat better than you have in the past. You have a few wolf pelts in your pack.
Yeah.
go ahead and on the next day, roll 1d20.
For flavor, I want to make sure I get some of those teeth for my boy.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Roll 1d20. Oh, plus 5. Plus 5. Oh, 20. Okay, great. Yeah, you're bringing them back for your son Beckett. Yes. You reach a familiar area and you regain your bearings and you find your way out of the woods.
Yay!
So, you return home victorious, earning an additional 15 glory for the year, and bringing a souvenir of a number of wolf teeth back for Beckett, who loves playing with them. How old is Beckett now?
I think he's 2.
Okay, right, yeah. So, you know, you're keeping them for when he's a little bit older and is unlikely to swallow them.
Yeah, I think I string one on a necklace for him to wear, like, in a year or two,
when
he's not, like, chewing on it.
Yeah. All right, awesome. Mark down your 15 glory. Let's calculate your annual glory and make sure that that's up to date.
Right, and we need to see if my son dies.
Yep, we got to do all that year-end stuff. So I'm going to give you a check to your hunting and to your courtesy for participating in the adventure of the forest.
Cool. And Lance, right? Because I...
Oh, yeah. Well, you crit, so yeah, you're great.
Great.
Yeah, so looks like you've got all of your annual glory rewards marked up there.
Yeah, so 175. Oops, sorry. 15. Did I get glory for getting married?
You should have, but
I don't know if we
didn't
decided,
you mark
like,
that down?
I don't think I did.
Oh, wow, you haven't been tracking your glory on your glory tab.
I know, I haven't. I've been, like, writing it, and it looks like shit. That's really bad.
Jess.
I'm sorry.
That's fine. I'm pretty sure we gave it to you.
Okay. I couldn't remember, like, what her background was.
It was a modest amount of glory. It wasn't crazy. It might have been 100. So let's see. Winter phase. Yeah, there you go. Okay, solo scenarios, experience rolls. So, go ahead and roll a test on each of your checked skills, hunting, courtesy, and lance. Your courtesy goes up.
Awesome.
As a result of your stressful encounter with the lady in the woods.
Well, I'll never do that again. Hunting.
Nope.
And lance.
Hey, your lance skill goes up. Very nice.
Cool. I think that was it.
Yep, totally. Of course, your age increases. You don't have any aging suffering.
Right.
We already did your economics. Stable roles are not necessary. Family roles. Are you going to try to have a child?
I don't think so. Not
okay.
this year.
Not this year. Roll on the child survival table.
Aye.
And let's see if anything happens to poor Beckett.
What is that?
It's 1d20.
1d20?
Mm-hmm. Okay, Beckett is fine. He doesn't choke on the wolf tooth.
Good.
He's great. Okay. Yes, training and practice. So, pull you over here. And you get to do one of these three things.
Awesome. My size is so funny.
What is your size?
It's 12.
That's right, because of that horrible cloak.
I got Well, yeah, and then I got like pummeled by a giant too.
Yep. Yeah.
So I like it though. I feel like obviously it's detrimental to rolls, but I like that I'm small.
I mean, 12 isn't crazy small, right? Like 10 is like average size. You're just not as large as you once were.
Yeah. Okay. I think I'm just about there.
Excellent. Then we will be able to get into the wedding itself.
Yes.
All right, so, yeah, I think it's early in the year 492 when you three are summoned by Earl Roderick to a great feast at Salisbury Castle, and so you get there and all of his knights are there, and many of them are like recovering from wounds that they suffered last year, or you know you see the effects of the most recent battle on the group here. There are many faces who are missing. Sir Elid is one of the most notable ones who is absent in the crowd, but generally people are in pretty good spirits. It's not every year that the Lord throws a feast for his all of his vassals. And as the evening continues, Earl Roderick steps up off of his table, off of his podium, and he speaks loudly, addressing the entire hall. And he says, My friends, my vassals, there is great news in Britain, for King Uther has sent word to me that he intends to marry the Lady Igraine, and she has accepted, and the entire country is rejoicing. All of us, for the role we have served in his battles and in his service, are invited to his feast and to help celebrate his matrimony to Igraine. So, we will all depart on the morrow for a week of feasting and celebration at Castle Tintagel.
Sweet.
A week?
A week?
Cool.
Are you surprised?
Is that normal? Is that like a big deal?
It's I think like marriage celebrations are probably a few days, but a week is a bit extravagant, especially when Uther is inviting all of his lords and all of their vassals. Like okay. It's going to be a big event.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Nice. So the three of you set off along with Earl Roderick the next day. Travel for, I think it's about 2 days away, something like that. It's fairly quick trip off to the coast in Cornwall to Castle Tintagel, which is the one right on the coast itself. And the entire place is just, it's pennanted, and you can hear like trumpets and music playing from various parts of the courtyard. There are tents pitched around. You see all of the local lords' banners waving in the air. A number of banners of local household knights for each of them. It seems like the entire kingdom has turned out. I think the last time we had like a really huge battle, it was like 4,000 knights. And there's probably like about 3,000 people who have turned out to Castle Tintagel for this. So is there anything you'd like to do here at the wedding as events are starting to get underway?
Go ahead.
Oh, there's just like lots of merrymaking and general feasting happening. There's always food and drink available everywhere. Yeah, just to give you an idea of the surroundings that you're in.
Yeah, I'm gonna go fucking buttonhole Roderick.
Yeah.
Whenever you're ready, I'm fucking gonna ride him.
Absolutely. Yeah, Roderick is he's speaking with Sir Ulfius, who is one of King Uther's most trusted advisors when you find him. And he turns to you and he says, "Ah, there he is right now. Sir Hrethric, please come meet Sir Ulfius." And Ulfius, I don't know if I've ever described him before. He's trim and well-muscled. He's wearing a blue tabard. He's about 45 years old. He's just got like a little bit of gray at his temples. And he looks a little bit flushed. He's had a drink or two already. And he's just delighted. He's happy to see you. He's happy to be here. And he holds out a hand and he clasps you by the hand. He says, "Hrethric, Sir Hrethric, I've heard great things of your exploits. How you cleaved the head off of that giant and the slaying of Gorlois. Truly, truly incredible, truly incredible."
"Oh, you humble me, sir. I assure you the tales are far taller than the deeds themselves."
"Ah," he claps you on the shoulder. "I'm sure they are, but still, valuable tales to be told. No? Now, you look as though you have business with your lord."
I don't wish to interrupt you, two great lords."
"Oh, please, please, no. We're all enjoying ourselves here. Don't mind me. We were just talking about my children."
"I hope they're all hale and well, my lord."
"Oh, well, Clint Corliss, Bradley Blakely, Lillian Lindsay, Lyndon Royce, Rylan Ridley, Whitney Wesley, Alden Ainsley, and Ashley are all doing very, very well. Though Ainsley did have a quick bout of the cold last year. Truly, we were quite worried about her, but she pulled through."
Just as an aside, out of character, I would just like to give Steven a persona point for just railing that list of me.
I had them written down, but
still. Dramatic readings.
The fact that you prepared like 20 children.
Sir Ulfius is very proud of his 15 children.
Sure. I mean, I'll banter with them for a while, but you know, when I get a minute, I'm gonna pull Roderick away and buttonhole.
Yeah. Would you like to test energetic or courtesy in order to simulate banter?
Simulating banter.
Yeah. Progress bar, boob.
Articulating points.
Suddenly, it's right now we're at Hrethric B, who is an android.
Normal human protocol. Engaged.
I don't feel like it's fair to do energetic because they're old men. So I'll try to move at their pace and play with courtesy.
Okay,
that's kind of ageist. I'm sure they rock out.
Dude. I don't know.
They want to wrestle. You know. Just
can I engage my glory since Ulfius invited it into the conversation as I banter courteously with
Yes, them. You can. That gives you plus +4 now. Is that what
yep.
it is?
Plus +4. Yep. Yep.
Oh,
God,
nice.
Damn it! Every time I do that, that's a yep. crit. That would have been a crit.
You ruined yourself. Yeah, you know, you banter most courteously, and Duke Ulfius is he's very pleased at your entry into the conversation. He starts so smacking his belly and says, "Do I smell turkey legs?" And then he sort of wanders off towards a nearby table. Roderick turns to you and he says, "Now, Roderick, you seem to have business. Tell me, what's on your mind?"
"I do, my lord. So, just also as an aside, has Roderick heard about the 100 Librem gift? Has it leaked? Or has Lycus kept his mouth shut?"
You know, Lycus is trying to like repay it back to you in favor.
Got it.
Let me see. Let me think if it would be something.
Maybe
that would...
an intrigue check for Roderick.
Yeah, actually, and he's probably quite good at it. He knows.
All right. Anyway, sire, I say, my lord,
This black cloak weighs heavy on my shoulders. I wish to take it off. It has been years since Yvonne has passed, and my daughter as well. And I wish to end my mourning, but I feel I can only do so with your kind assistance.
Oh, well, I understand. No young ladies have caught your eye.
I am inept at these matters.
You didn't let me meet any, Stephen.
Yeah. I also, goddamn it, have you running all over the goddamn world killing shit?
Yeah, exactly.
So yeah. Instead of saying that, I just say, yeah, I, my lord, these are not my specialty.
Yeah. He nods. He says, "Well, Hrethric, I know that there are many, many appealing women here at this event. Actually, not least of which is Sir Ulfius' oldest daughter, Corliss, and his younger daughter Blakely, though she is recent to the ways of romance. But you should speak with him and earn his approval. Perhaps I can arrange for you to meet one of these fine young women in the course of your of the week.
If you could make the necessary arrangements, my lord, I would be even deeper in your debt.
Yes. Yes, of course. You know, it comes to mind that I believe that the Lady Corliss has been friends of Sir Lycus's family for some time. I will see what can be done. Yes.
Yes. Like, wait, why is he bringing up Sir Lycus? What? What's going on there?
Yeah.
All right, cool. All right. But I give him a little hard-eyed stare, like, I'm serious, motherfucker.
Yeah, right. We gotta make this happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, yeah, I'm about to fucking hit 5,000 glory.
That's a lot of glory. You're close. Cool. Nidian and Elaine, did you all want to do anything specific at the events?
Nidian, surely. Yeah. Surely, yeah. So I got a few things I wanted to do.
All right.
So the first thing, obviously, I wanted to do is this. I'm going to try to actually gun here for a proud check.
Okay.
I am literally strutting around here in my sweetest, nicest Venetian clothes, like Macklemore, just
yeah,
like
Macklemore, the fur coat from the thrift shop, like
what? Yeah, sure, but like. Very, very nice silks, and I'm like walking around. No, I'm doing just. I'm not saying anything yet to people. There's just that slow motion cut of me, just like, you know, heads up.
Yeah,
to different
right.
People.
Yeah, like, it's very God, who am I remembering? It's like Lonely Island, what's his name from Brooklyn Nine-Nine, Jake Peralta, where he's like,
yeah,
it's like slow motion. Yeah, exactly. So we see a shot of you walking through one of the grand halls, just like waving to your people that you know and like winking at people.
Yeah.
There's the Lady Jenna sitting at a table with all of her ladies in waiting, and she goes.
Yeah, no, that's where I'm going to. That's my line.
Yeah.
Right? I'm going right to her.
She sees you entering the hall and being all cool. You walk up. What do you do?
I am going to be a little bit, okay, here's what I'm going to do. I come up to her and I say, "Lady Jenna, how do you do?" And how do you fare? And, I think I'm going to, like, after, regardless of what she says, I'm going to follow up being like, "So, I got these nice furs. From my new, brand new hunting areas on my property. I was thinking maybe you would maybe like one of these. Maybe we should go hunting sometime, you know?
Yeah.
I could have one of these, you know, something or something even finer adorned for you." Like,
yeah.
Basically, I'm trying to ask her out on a date to go hunting.
On a hunting date. Like, yeah. And her eyes light up. She says, "Oh, you slew the beasts yourself. What kind of furs are they?"
Wolf.
Yeah.
As a nod. As
rabbit.
A...
rabbit. Rabbit fur. Yeah. She reaches out and like
nothing special. Just dire wolf.
She reaches out and like rubs your chest through the wolf fur, and she's like, yeah. "It feels so nice."
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Oh,
ooh. This is getting good.
Where's Sir Sutton?
Where does
he emerge from his wolf cloak?
Sir Sutton is not far. Have no fear.
Good.
Yeah, she's impressed. She says, "Oh, well, I do enjoy hunting." And then you feel an arm drape around your shoulder, and you look next to you, and there is Sir Sutton. His grin wide, his teeth sparkling, ting.
Yep. And
his lion cloak spilling from his back. He says, "Did someone say hunting? Say, Sir Nidian, will you be joining in the hunt this week?"
Oh, of course, Sir Sutton. I would love to. I was just telling the Lady Jenna about my new hunting grounds.
Yeah. Would you like to test your pride to see if you deliver this in an impressively prideful manner?
Yeah. I mean, my pride's 5, so this is gonna be real.
Oh, this will be great. Yeah. Totally.
Yeah. No.
Oh, you rolled a 15 testing against a 5, so you fail.
So I'm too modest.
Yeah.
Right? I'm too modest. I'm like. I mean, I think I could. This is a really important engagement. I'm not sure. I have so many plans. I'm going to have to really get back to you. I don't know. I'm thank you so much for the honor, though.
Yeah. He claps you on the back. He says, "Nonsense, nonsense. I feel that you and I have a real bond, after the events of last year. You were so distraught, and I helped you out, didn't I?"
Oh, that's right. Oh, Jess, that's right. You missed that. Nidian went apeshit on Sutton through his melancholy. Sutton tried to pull him out of it. He had failed a passion test. And Nidian went ballistic on him. But Sutton just like hugged it out.
Nidian
broke down like blubbering. It was great.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it was really good. It was really good.
Sir Sutton is the best rival.
Wow.
Yeah, he sort of like smiles at you and like winks at the Lady Jenna, and then he's like, "Well, I have friends to attend to. I'll see you tomorrow morning, right? Be there." Yeah. And the Lady Jenna says, "Bye, Sutton."
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Him and the whole lacrosse team.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. He just pops his collar as he's walking away.
He's wearing 3 pop collars.
Yes.
All right.
Jess, is there anything that Elaine wanted to get up to?
She wants to see if the woman that she like mortally offended is here.
Oh yeah.
And try to figure out who she actually is and what manor she comes from.
Yeah,
get a sense of where she was.
Do an awareness check.
Okay.
Oh wow. Okay, let me see. I need to write down some more information about this lady.
Sorry.
Give me an intrigue roll and see if you can like find out more information just from talking to people around. But fairly quickly, you do see her in the crowds.
Okay, she's here.
Yes. Oh wow. Damn, Elaine.
Intrigue.
The Lady Chelsea is.
Lady Chelsea. Okay.
Is she's a bachelorette knight. And she is considered eccentric, but many of the local stewards are keenly interested in her and her attributes. So she's always very fashionably dressed.
Mm-hmm.
And she's here today in a let's see, I guess it's like a white silk gown with golden brocade around the edging. so fashionable.
Is she there with
anyone in particular? Or, I mean, she's with a couple of like her companions, but there's nobody that she seems to be like attached to.
Mm-hmm.
You find that she is a very temperate knight. She's renowned for her lack of indulgence. And true to form, as you observe, she passes over a few cups of wine that are offered to her. And her plate seems to be dressed with a very healthy and modest assortment of foods.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
She is very rich. She, I think she has a few suitors who are obviously sort of pursuing her. Let's see. You find out that she has some preferences. Let's see. She has a great fondness for heraldry.
Uh-huh.
For playing instruments and for gaming.
Ah. Okay.
Yes.
What sort of games might like it? Does it differ? Are we playing like
the most dangerous game?
Like like lady games, like sort of courtly games, or?
Well, you're both knights, right?
Like straight up jousting. Like
it's probably it's probably like gambling or card games or things like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's this game called Gwent.
Have you ever heard of Gwent? Let's see. Let me just double check what the game skill refers to. I think there's more information.
Yeah, I wanna try to befriend this woman. I wanna try to like patch things up so she's just like a total weirdo.
I mean, this woman's really, really good at gaming, and like she actually started to like do performances of gaming, and people like watch her and started a subscription. It's pretty cool.
So there's the Roman tabula, which is like backgammon, the Saxon Hnaftafel, swords and shields, the Cymric, oh god, I'm not even going to try to pronounce it. It's Gwyddbwyll or something like that. But I know that I'm butchering the Celtic.
It's Swords and Strongholds.
It's
a game available on Vertical HQ.
Indeed, yes. It's called Wooden Wisdom and the Continental Les Dames, which is checkers. Those are the games that she enjoys. Yeah, you see her. Are you going to go try to talk to her?
Yes.
Okay.
I am. Might be stupid, but I am.
Yeah.
Elaine's kind of proud.
Okay. All right.
She, she's dressed as finely she possibly can be.
Are you trying to angle for playing up Elaine's pride here?
I think so.
Okay. Yeah.
Without offending this woman, hopefully.
Probably she has a suitor speaking to her right now. Some young man who's very nicely dressed and, he's very beautiful in a way that many knights are not, because they live a hard life, and this man has clearly spent more of his time inside of a manor or a castle or something like that, attending to various political events.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, I don't butt in. I wait for an opportunity to interject, wait for a moment in the conversation where they are perhaps talking about cards or
something. So you do want to interject, but you want to wait until it seems relevant.
Yes.
Okay, cool. Yep. What is your proud? 14. All right, not bad. Yeah, I think she's sort of laughing and like, you know, pushing at this gentleman's shoulder, and he seems very relaxed. And she I don't think she's noticed you, and she says, "Yes, would you fancy a game of backgammon?" And the gentleman says, "Oh, well, I haven't played very much, but perhaps you can teach me."
Mm-hmm.
She says, "Oh yes, no, that sounds most enjoyable."
I pretend to have just been idly passing by with a drink in my hand, and I'm like, "Oh, did I hear tell of backgammon? I do enjoy a good game of backgammon. Oh, may God. I watch you?
It's so amazing. Roll against your proud.
Does she recognize me at all?
Let's see.
I don't think I'm going to say who I am.
Yeah, let's see if she does. Her recognize probably isn't great. Let's see. What's your recognize? 7. Oh, she's got the same.
Okay.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. She doesn't. She doesn't recognize you. She looks at you and she's like, she sort of gestures to her companion. And her companion, he actually looks over at you and he says, oh, you don't play backgammon.
Yeah, I didn't see you at the local backgammon tournament.
and he smiles and he says, she can teach us both, please. We can learn together.
Lovely.
Yeah, she sort of grits her teeth a little bit. Yes, of course. Of course. So she sets up the board and gets out the cards. Yeah. You start playing backgammon together. I guess like she's playing with him and explaining the rules to you as this is going on.
Uh-huh.
Let's think. Do you want to make a gaming test to see how well you understand?
Sure.
Or is there something else?
Very bad at gaming.
Or is there another test that might be appropriate?
Flirting.
My venery.
Yeah, sure. I mean, that's going to be a lot more effective on this steward than it is on this knight.
Yeah, I want to be in her favor. I don't necessarily want to. I want to buddy up to this lady.
I mean, maybe courtesy is the right,
yeah.
the right approach. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, I think I'm.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah, so I'm just like, you know, like very, very intrigued with all of the rules she's explaining and like oh really, well I the way I've played it, the older way is blah 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 blah, and like we're like comparing like
yeah comparing notes
tactics
for
yeah.
sure. And she says she turns to you, she's like, cards? No, backgammon uses dice.
oh
yeah. Cool. Yeah. Like, you know, she seems to be getting into the swing of things, and, like, it's obvious to her that you don't really play very much, but she's enjoying telling you about it, and the gentleman next to you, let's name him. Oops. His name is Broderick. Yeah, he's also is paying a lot of attention, though he doesn't really... Well, no, he's probably a lot more versed in the games than you are. He's done this before. He's just sort of flattering the Lady Chelsea.
He's played backgammon with the designer.
Yeah, exactly. Broderick. Yeah. Cool. So she shows you the ropes. Through her game with Broderick. And it's clear that Broderick knows what he's doing. And as a result, she turns to you and she says, so, is it clear? Would you fancy a game?
Yes, I would.
Very well. And then she resets the board and hands you the dice. And the two of you set to playing. Go ahead and roll your gaming skill.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So she trounces you very quickly. Yeah. But, you know, she's sort of amused. And she kind of stretches and she says, well, you know, it's been really fun. But Broderick, darling, why don't we go admire some of the heraldry from our visiting knights?
Mm-hmm.
What do you do in response?
I take my leave at this point. I just... I'm very gracious, and I say, I always enjoy learning about games. Games are a passion of mine. And is it appropriate for me to already know her name and address her as Chelsea?
I mean, you could certainly be like, I've inquired as to you because you were you know, you were curious to me for your skill at gaming, so I know that you're the Lady Chelsea.
Yes, I have heard of your impeccable skill in gaming, Lady Chelsea, and had a wonderful time learning and playing with you, and you are welcome anytime to my manor, which I've forgotten what it is called. Newton Tony.
And the words Newton Tony, mm-hmm. they kind of, she goes, Newton Tony.
Yes.
And then she looks down at you and looks up at you, and then she says, ah, I didn't recognize you when you weren't covered in shit.
Oh!
Ah, yes. You know how adventures go, my fellow knight.
Hmm. Yes, well, I certainly haven't had any that ended up like that. Tell me, what on earth were you doing in the forest?
Well, I take this opportunity to lay out my very heroic slaying of three gigantic wolves. I pull out teeth from my pocket.
Yeah. She, like, her lips tighten. And
it's all in good fun.
Yeah, and Broderick sort of blanches, and he says... He puts his hand on her shoulder and he says, "Milady, would you care to go visit the hounds? I know how much you love canines."
They're weird. Yes. They're I scared Danzig away, screaming weird.
Yeah, and she just sort of like clips through her teeth. She says, "Good day, Sir Elaine." And she turns on her heels and the storms off.
God.
Yeah. All right. So, there's dancing, singing, and merrymaking in the evening, and you all get word that tomorrow there's going to be a grand hunt in honor of Uther's wedding to Igraine.
Totally. So, Steven, I just had a quick question, meta question, I guess. Does Lycus have children that need to be married off?
I think Sir Sutton is his child. Like that's the main. Oh. Yeah, Sir Sutton is Lycus's son.
Oh shit! Sorry, Nid. I'm gonna be fucking crossing the line.
Quick question for you, Steven.
Yes.
What are some valid reasons for not partaking in the hunt that
you could? Any reason is valid for not partaking in that. Like it's not by any means a requirement to go. But
is Earl Roderick going?
Yeah, are you joking? It's like it's a super knightly thing to go on the hunt. Everybody's like, yeah, let's go hunt. We're gonna get some wolves. The lady Chelsea's who's, just like,
right.
Who's the master at arms here at the castle?
Oh, the
who's in charge of defense? Because I want to ask if they need any help shoring up the security of the wedding and everything around here. And that might take all day. I might not be able to go hunting. I might not be able to make a fool of myself.
Yeah, there's a Sir Thabert of Marlborough, a woman with thick red hair, wearing a green silk dress. She has wild eyes. She's the garrison commander at Tintagel. Okay. And she's very enthusiastic to meet you.
I need to figure this out though, because maybe this needs to be some type of passion role or some kind of trait, because it's like I want to impress Lady Jenna, but I'm terrified of making a fool of myself in front of everybody here. This kind of thing. Like, is this like, oh no, I have to do it right now? Like it's kind of thing for me. Or
wait. Can I jump in?
Yes.
Yeah. So, please help me out.
So Elaine and I,
because I'm a coward too,
arm in arm talking about you know stuff that you know what we missed over the last year and whatnot. And one of the things I'm telling her about is Nidian's new magnificent estate and how excited he must be to take his new hunting skills. Like he's got a hunting lodge now and he's become obsessed with hunting. Must be the pinnacle of his year. Nidian, oh, so good to see you. I'm so excited for the hunt. Did you buy new jodhpurs?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I did, but I'm not sure. I haven't broken them in yet. They're a little, it's a little awkward. I'm not sure if I'm, you know, I don't think I'm going to go on this hunt. I want you to convince me to go on it, right?
I'm sure
there's
fun.
Actually some other, you know, I left my really nice boots at home and you know, those are my lucky ones. I'm not sure. You know, what do you think?
Oh, you don't need luck, Nidian.
Yeah. What?
No?
I'm okay. Surprised. Is there? Are you ill? I feel his forehead.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You've been doing nothing but talking about hunting for the better part of 2 years now.
I know, and now I'm not gonna, and I'm like shying away from it, and yeah, I'm like, no, you know, I'm just not really, my clothes aren't really, I'm not really outfitted for the hunt here. I'm not sure. I don't have my horse with me here. It feels awkward. You know, I don't feel like in this, I'm just trying to make up just excuse after excuse.
You are dressed in the finery, the most finest finery I have ever seen, and it is a bit of a pageant. Are you worried you'll get your clothes soiled?
No, I mean, I brought an alternate sets for hunting to get soiled, so that's not a problem. But it's more just, I don't know, like, it's going to rain tomorrow, and it's just, I don't want to be all wet and disgusting for the wedding, you know? And I'm just really...
In 3 days.
Really, I know, I'm making some, like, really, like...
Yeah, weak arguments.
I know, I like the mean, like...
And I want you just to... To convince, just
Nydia,
just tell
my
me.
Dear friend, what plagues you? It cannot be this hunt.
It's a matter of my heart as I look at it.
Now, Nydian,
for
me as game master, I feel like you've put enough effort into pursuing the Lady Jenna that it's appropriate to give you a love of Jenna passion.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds good.
Would you like to roll 3d6?
Yeah, I roll 3d6 right now.
3d6?
All right. Oh. Yeah, you've got a love of Jenna of 10.
Wow.
Not bad.
All right. That could have been a lot worse.
It could have.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So do you feel like you've earned a hatred of Sutton?
Not yet. Okay. I feel like that might be after the hunt.
Okay, cool.
Especially because Sutton's just been so nice. He's been a nice boy to me, actually. He's, like, calmed me down from my melancholy.
Totally, mm-hmm. Yep.
This is actually a really good moment. So, like, back in the in the scene when I say, like, it's a matter of my heart, and this is the first time I say, like, I confess that Sir Sutton is quite the knight, and I think I have my match set out. You know, I have a really, really upcut big match ahead of me. Competing for Lady Jenna's heart. This may be the toughest endeavor I've ever set out to accomplish, as I kind of say. And
well, then you must approach it like Sir Nydian would, and have a insane battle plan.
the battlefield
against all odds.
And but then, I am blind on this battlefield. The fog of war shrouds. Love is a battlefield.
Yep,
don't you
know?
Yep. I do not know the tactics. I need centuries. This is unfamiliar terrain to me.
You're flirting.
My heart has never felt this way before. Not for someone. It's beautiful.
Is there no book you can
amazing,
read?
Lady Jenna.
You asked if there was no book he can read, Herathric?
Yeah. Yeah.
That.
I can't read. I hope there's pictures.
I hope.
No. No, what do you say? I want you guys to try to, like, you know, just give me a sweet ass friendly pep talk. I'm going on the hunt. Just give me a nice awesome pep talk.
All right, let me see.
Just boost my esteem up, friends. That's what I want right now.
I think Retha would go on the fuck that guy. like Hrethor would just be hyped to hunt. Like, Nydian, I've been waiting to go hunting with you for 2 years. Like, come on, let's just fuck that guy. Forget Jenna. Let's just go hunt. Like, we'll get up really early in the morning. We'll be the first ones out there. And we'll hunt.
Oh. Oh my God, yes. That's amazing, dude. Luke, that's amazing. And so you do the thing, like, you know, yeah, exactly. It's like, you know what? Noah will calm you. Yeah, exactly. The Noah will calm you down. It's not, ignore Lady Jenna and stuff like that. How about if that's too much for you to do? How about just a good hunt with your friends?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's like, yeah. Like, that's perfect, Luke. Thank you. Yes.
Awesome. Ah, all right,
good.
Nydian.
Yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. We're gonna do this so much. Come on, yeah, that's gonna be amazing. Yeah, yeah.
We're gonna hunt so much.
Yeah.
We're gonna be done back at the tents before they're even rolling out.
All right. Yeah. Epic. All right, so the night falls and Nidin is like punching the air like, yeah! Fuck yeah! Yeah. And on the morrow, we will see the hunt. But let us take a 5-minute break, and then when we come back, we can see what comes out of the excursion. So don't go anywhere. We'll be back in 5 minutes.